ROI is a very important concept. This is some other research from the Standish group. This research, they went out to a bunch of different companies to look at how those companies used software. And the results were really quite remarkable. They looked at out-of-the-box software, like Microsoft Office that you can just open and use. They looked at custom-developed software where the company had built something for themselves. They looked at customized software where the company had bought a package and then customized around that. And they found that only 7% of features are always used, like file open, file close, right? Always used. Unless it crashes and file closed may not happen. That happens sometimes. 13% of features are often used. Whenever we're using something like Excel, we go in and we do multiplication and division and all of those things. We use them very, very often. There are other features that are sometimes used. Maybe you use features like min and max. Maybe some more complicated formulas. We sometimes use those. There are some features that are seldom used. Microsoft Excel, for example, supports sine and cosine. These are formulas built in. Has anybody ever used sine or cosine in Microsoft Excel?
What the hell?
I'm sorry. Who's paying for that feature?
The VR.
My boss.
Would you have not bought the product if that feature was not included? Actually, that's something I think we can still think about, might have some value in some cases. I actually have had one person legitimately respond that yes, they have used that feature. So on behalf of that one person, I would like to thank all of you for paying for that feature, for that one person to use it. The really scary number is this last number. 45% of requirements are never used. If you go into Excel, if you look across the top level menus, there may be things that you've never used. If you look at the second level menus, there are certainly things you've not used. If you open Help, oh my God, there are things in there I don't even know how to pronounce. I'm not proposing that their statistics are necessarily precise. In America, we have a saying, there are lies, damn lies, and statistics. So I'm not arguing that their statistics are necessarily precise, but in every product I've used, I find that there's a lot of features that are useless. Steve Jobs was on a phone call to, you guys know Nike, sports shoes, apparel. A gentleman had just become the new CEO of Nike. And so he was on the phone with Steve Jobs, and Steve Jobs was congratulating him. And so the guy asked him, so Mr. Jobs, do you have any recommendations for me? What I can do? And Steve said, no. He said, you're doing great. You know, you've got a great job coming up through the company ranks. You've got, I do have one piece of advice. He said, Nike makes great products. Products that customers must have. But you also make some crap. Quit making the crappy stuff. That was his advice. And the CEO of Nike said he was absolutely right. Do any of you work overtime? Let me see a show of hands for anyone who works overtime.
It should be the other way.
Yeah, does anybody not work overtime?
We have no hands, right? We work all the time.
You know where overtime comes from? 45%. You're spending nearly half of your time developing stuff that nobody's ever going to use. Yeah, think a little bit differently. You know the Pareto principle? The 80-20 rule. It's not really a rule, but in any statistically large data set, we will see this emerge. Imagine if we apply this 80-20 rule to our projects. If we have sorted, ordered our requirements by their return on investment, it's actually possible for us to recognize the highest percentage of value with only 20% of our effort. In 20% of our effort, we can get 80% of our effect. So looking back at the project that we just had, these six sprints, we spent a couple of weeks developing this product. And after we've developed this product, we could spend the rest of our time to gain another 20% of the product's value. So we get a big bang effect, right? 100% of the product delivered, 100% of the value delivered. These are classical project management assumptions that are usually wrong. Whenever I've delivered 100% of my product, do I really get 100% of the projected value? How many of you know about the HP touchpad? They delivered 100% of a product. Did they get back 100% of their projected value? No. They've now canceled that. I'm very proud of HP for doing that. It was brave. It was agile. This idea that we will get 100% of our return whenever we've delivered 100% of our product is a stupid, it's insane. It's a crazy way of doing things. But it's the way we've done things for the last 30 years. What if, instead of continuing to develop that next two sprints, the next 20% of that project, what if we instead took that 80% complete product and put it out to the market to see how they responded? We've only spent 20% of our budget, and we can see how the market responds to that. That's going to take a little bit of time, right? We're not going to get a market response immediately. So what if during that time, we actually spent our team's time working on another project where we could get 80% of the value in a couple of sprints? And what if, instead of working on this third section, we considered applying our team again to get a third project where we might get 80% of our value? If we followed a traditional approach, we would have invested 100% of our time, 6 weeks, to get a theoretical return of 100%. That would be untested. We wouldn't know whether we're going to get 100% or 50% or 200% until those 6 weeks are up. If we use this approach, we can actually get a much more interesting theoretical return. Our theoretical return, 240%. This is the way to do business in internet time. This is the way to manage projects in internet time. Build a little bit. Get it in front of your customer. Let your customer tell you, is this something that I want or not? If I've built 80% and I ship it out to the customer and nobody's interested, what should I do?
Stop.
Stop. There's no reason to invest that additional 80% of my budget. I've already saved money by killing the project early. There are agile companies that do this. So another question, when should we deliver? When do we hit this 80-20 goal? This is the iPhone 4. There are people who say this is revolutionary. This should have been Apple's first phone. Could Apple have delivered this as their first phone? Could they have delivered this iPhone 4 as their first iPhone? Sure. Because they can deliver it now. They could have waited, researched, analyzed, and delivered this as their first phone. But they would have been stupid to do so. And Apple is not stupid. Apple is an agile company. Instead, Apple took a different approach. Instead of thinking that they wanted to deliver this, they said, no, that's not the right way. Instead, they delivered this. Notice, sorry, it's not on the screen. Do you know how many applications there were on the original iPhone? Anybody remember a long, long time ago? 5 years, right? 5 years is a long time, internet time. On the original iPhone, there were some blank places on the home screen. So the home screen will hold 16 applications. They have less than that. They have about 14 or 15. Why would Apple do that? If we go back 6 years and look at what industry analysts were saying, they thought there was no hope for Apple. How can they compete against companies like Nokia? Or the grandfather of all smartphones, Palm, that great company. Or the company that owns the corporate phone structure, RIM. How can Apple compete with these companies? Did Apple know that they could compete? They didn't know. So, what did they do? They released a minimally shippable product. They released a product with the least amount of capabilities that they could release to validate their product. The 80-20 rule. Do you think that Apple was worried about the budget after they released their first phone? Remember we talked about the Hugo and the BMW? This big bucket idea? If I'm going to do something once, I'm going to consider every possible thing. So I'm going to have this ugly big budget? I don't think they have any budget worries. The product supports its own development. As soon as they had launched this, the money they were making made the concept of budgeting irrelevant. They're not worried about budgeting through the iPhone 10. Apple also demonstrated another agile concept of inspecting and adapting. When Steve Jobs introduced this on stage, he said, I've given you the best browser available on a mobile device. Go out and make browser-based applications. And developers said, no, we really want to create native apps. Please give us a way to create native apps. I don't think Apple planned on giving that capability to developers. They truly believed that using web applications was the wave of the future. But they inspected and they adapted. They said, if that many people are interested, maybe there's a market there. And so we have the App Store. And the App Store is billions of dollars in revenue, all from learning. So we already talked about, when should we stop developing a product? Yeah. If there's no more return, we should stop developing a product. If we go out and look at our features relative to their value, if we prioritize them relative to our value, if we ship them early and let customers actually validate that value, we can know precisely when we should stop. We don't have to think about a big bucket. It's not everything or nothing. It could be 80-20. We're able to deliver on a given date. And the most valuable things that can be done by that date will be done. And the other stuff is probably part of that 45% that you're never going to use anyway. Throw it away. This is an agile way of thinking. That talks about doing the right thing the right way. Sometimes we don't do the right thing, but if we do them the right way, we can still win. Now I'll use Google, someone mentioned before, as an example of a company that's learned from this. Google really wants to be Apple when they grow up. They really want to diversify. And when they saw how well Apple was doing around some of its product development, Google said, hey, let's develop a product of our own. And so they developed the Google phone. They launched it in the US on Verizon. And soon after they launched it, customers started calling Verizon and saying, we need help. And Verizon said, it's not our phone, you'll have to talk to Google. And then the people wanted to call Google, and guess what? Google doesn't have a phone number. Google wants to do everything on forums and email. Google very soon learned they weren't in a position to provide the type of customer support that would be demanded for that type of a product. So what did they do? They did a very smart thing. They stopped making They did a smart thing in making Android available to everyone. So they're able to keep a foothold in the market. But they were smart enough to stop. There are some companies that don't stop. So the concepts that I've shared with you, they're working. They're working very well. I was in London last week, and there was a speaker. He's actually spoke at the last two Scrum gatherings. He's not a traditional agilist. He is someone who's worked in management consulting and worked extensively in the financial sector for the World Bank was where he started. And he brought up a chart that's comparing some companies that are using this agile mindset to companies that continue to follow a traditional approach to project management, to portfolio management. He compared Amazon.com, one of our sponsors, right, to Walmart. Look at what Amazon's stock price has done. Look at their market compared to Walmart. Look at Apple. And what they've done compared to what was a darling just a few years ago in Cisco. Salesforce.com. The way they've grown, the way they're delivering, it's sent shockwaves through the industry. SAP is now a big, and they have huge interest in learning to do things a different way, because they know they're falling behind. This is working. We still have a lot of room to go, but it is working. So I leave you today with this thought. Think differently. Think about how you can achieve more value in less time. Think about how you can validate that earlier. Think about how you can create a minimally shippable product. To me, as someone who's been involved in products for a long time, I aspire to no less than what Steve Jobs said we should be doing, which is changing the world. We have the potential to do that. We now have the best tools that we've ever had to do that. I challenge you as project managers to broaden your thinking. Learn more about these tools and techniques. There's a lot we can do to maximize value in projects. And the way we're doing it now is not the right way. So thank you very much. I think we still may have a few minutes left for questions if anyone has say.
Ladies and gentlemen, there are mics on the aisles. If you have any questions for Mr. Vernon Stinebaker. wish to reserve your questions during lunch and our respective tea break. Our speaker will be here throughout the rest of the day. So ladies and gentlemen, let's give a round of applause.